on orientation. My name is Josh Thompson, the Director of New Student Orientation, and we are thrilled to have you joining us for our first ever live stream session. We'll be bringing these to you throughout the next month, from now through July 1st is our final session. They'll be taking place on Tuesdays and Wednesdays from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m., and we're super thankful that you joined us, and we're glad you're here today, and it's my honor and privilege to introduce our guests at this time. Well, actually, why don't I let them introduce themselves. Nancy, take it away.
I am the Director of Employee Relations, Talent Acquisition and Development in the Human Resources and Payroll Department here at Western. I've been here for about 4 years and just love it. Love being a catamount. And I would say since COVID-19 and quarantine, I thought I'd see what all the fuss was about and have been binge watching Downton Abbey and love it.
Excellent. And you were telling me a little bit before we got started, actually getting into some hair cutting for yourself. Yeah,
I did.
Looks fantastic.
I thought I would see if I could cut my hair myself, and I did the unicorn ponytail and probably took off 4 inches more than I meant to.
Well, like I said, it looks fantastic, and we were talking earlier, and the more restraint, like you said, the fact that you're able to stop yourself is probably better than I would be able to do. Catherine, tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name's Catherine. I am the Assistant Director for Financial Aid at Western. I manage the Work Study Program. I've been back at Western for about 2 years. I went to school here, did undergrad, had a chance to come back, and jumped on it. So I'm really glad to be here.
Except, no, Catherine, you said undergrad. So what made you want to come back and work professionally here?
The mountains, just the mountains. It's a beautiful place. Western's a really great place to be. And yeah, I spent so much time here that coming back, I leapt at it. It was a really good opportunity to be where I wanted to be.
That's awesome. I know that for a lot of alumni, coming back feels like coming home. So, excellent. Well, thank you for joining us, Catherine. And Michael, finally, certainly not least, tell us about yourself.
Hey, my name is Michael Lyons. I work for Human Resources and Payroll. I handle non-work study student employment. So if you're going to be taking a non-work study position, I'm sure we're going to meet at some point. And love Western. I've been here close to a year now. Love the mountains. I'm going to look forward to helping you all out next semester. Any questions you have, don't just hesitate to drop me a line.
Thank you, Michael. That was an excellent segue because you mentioned exactly what we're here to talk about tonight, and that is student employment from both an HR perspective, so that non-work study piece, and then Catherine from Financial Aid is going to be joining us to talk about work study. But Nancy, why don't you lead us off here and tell us kind of a little bit about HR and student employment at Western.
Okay. Well, as part of your educational experience here at Western Carolina University, we have non-work study student employment that's available to you. This is not the same as work study, which is managed by the financial aid office, which Catherine is going to tell you a little bit more about later on. There are a variety of jobs that are available on campus that include opportunities such as driving a Catran shuttle, recreation center staff, you could be a RAF guide, grounds workers, we have tutors, office assistants, residential assistants, to name just a few of the positions. All of our positions are paid minimum wage or higher depending upon the particular job. And I'm going to turn it over to Michael so that he can tell you a little bit about eligibility.
All right, so some eligibility requirements for non-work study employment. There's a couple of GPA hours and credit requirements. We'll start with GPA. First semester students, of course, don't have an established GPA, but they are still permitted to work on campus. Then after that, when you do establish a GPA, a 2.0 minimum is going to be required. And some departments may require higher than that, and that should be noted on their postings for the jobs. Hours, the students are permitted to work 25 hours combined a week in a semester. And what I mean by that is students may work more than one position, whether that be to non-work study, a work study, a non-work study, whatever the case may be. But the total cannot exceed 25 hours. And we do this basically so you can focus on your education. Now, during the summer, you're allowed to work 40 hours as long as you're enrolled in classes in the fall. The next semester. 20 hours a week is going to be the limit for non-resident alien F1, J1 visa student that are eligible for student employment. finally, the credit hour requirement. In the fall and the spring, you must be registered for 6 credit hours. In the summer, you must be registered for 3 to work. Or if you're not registered for any classes, then you must be registered in the following semester, the fall, for 6 credit hours. Now let me just go over that again, because I know that might be a little confusing. Spring and fall, 6 credit hours for undergraduate. And then in the summer, you can be registered for 3 to work. But if you're not registered at all, just make sure you're registered for the following semester, fall, for at least 6 credit hours. Now to go over some more requirements, I'm going to pass it back over to Nancy.
Okay. All newly hired students paid by WCU for employment must complete the eligibility verification form. This is a federal form. It's called, some of you may be familiar with it, it's known as the I-9 form, and in order for us to start working. This is a requirement of U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Act. Section 1 of the form is completed as part of the onboarding process for our students. Our onboarding process is all electronic and actually can be done on your telephone. It's very simple and easy to complete. Section 2, however, must be completed in person with human resources. This is where we have to verify your eligibility for employment in the United States, as well as your identity. If you are not able to come in person, there is a feature that we can set up a remote agent if you are not able to come to campus and you will be working remotely. Original identification is required. We cannot accept any copies of identification. So a current passport or other form of identification from List A is required. List A will actually give you employment and identity verification. List B and C, one from each. One is for identity, the other is for employment eligibility. List B, the most popular is a driver's license, will qualify, and for List C, the other most popular item is a Social Security card. Again, it must be an original Social Security card, an original driver's license. I cannot emphasize that enough. If you do not have the proper identification, we will not be able to start work until you do. So you want to make sure that when you come to campus that you are bringing those things with you in the event that you would like to work on campus. The other requirement is direct deposit. All employees, including students, must be paid via direct deposit. We do not do any paper checks at all. You'll need a voided check, a deposit slip, or else a letter from your bank verifying your account number and your routing number in order to set up your direct deposit. If you do online banking, oftentimes you can go online and there is a form, a direct deposit form that you can actually download that you can bring with you as well. To find a listing for any available positions that are on campus, you would go to jobcat.wcu.edu. The address is also listed in your Quick Start guides that you have received. And when you identify the position that you're interested in, you would do an electronic application. Once you submit your application, the hiring manager takes over. They conduct interviews and make hiring decisions. And then once they do that, then human resources will step back in again. And that's where you meet Michael.
And just to add to that, Nancy, you can also see all this information on our website at go.wcu.edu/studentjobs. And all the information that we went over today should be on that Quick Start guide that orientation gave.
Excellent. And so one of the things we want to highlight for those students who have started summer semester, or online orientation is available for you. If you've completed all of your steps, you log in through Blackboard and you can access that. And then part of, you guys mentioned the Quick Start Guide is where you can find some of this information. That's located in your virtual bag, which is, again, part of your Blackboard module. So just scroll down until you see Virtual Information Fair. Then you can click on Virtual Bag and find the Quick Start Guide for all of that information, kind of examples of the I-9 documentation, things like that. So for those who are not starting with us until fall for incoming students, then don't worry, your access you'll be able to get starting this Monday, June the 1st. So be on the lookout for that if you're curious for more information. Catherine, now we want to talk a little bit more about work study, which is kind of the opposite end of the coin of what Michael and Nancy do.
Excellent. Thank you, Josh. So federal work study is the program that allows students to work using financial aid funding, meaning they have to complete a FAFSA. So what will happen is the student will complete a FAFSA. They'll explicitly indicate that they're interested in work study by marking yes on that question on the FAFSA. From there, a financial aid offer will be put together for them. Once they arrive at campus, they can begin looking for a job at JobCat. And once they locate a job, they'll interview with the supervisor, complete all hiring documentation with that supervisor, bring all of that information to the financial aid office in 105 Cordelia Camp Building, and I will process the information for you there. At that time, you'll get a start date, and we'll also do the federal I-9 that Nancy mentioned before. So the best practice is to make sure that when you come to campus, bring the appropriate identification with you. And if you have any questions about that identification, you can reach out to workstudy@wcu.edu.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Catherine. And we do encourage all of you watching along to submit your questions. Those are going to be funneled in right here to me. So we'll start off with a couple of questions. We'll do our best to kind of ping pong back and forth between work study and non-work study and kind of documentation necessary. Let's start with a question for you, Catherine. If we were waitlisted for the work study program and haven't heard anything yet, what should we expect for the upcoming year when trying to get a job? And then the second part of that question, how do jobs outside of work study work? And we'll have Michael and Nancy kind of address that.
I'll begin working the work study waitlist the first week of school, time permitting. That's usually opening week is usually a pretty busy time for us, but that is something that is definitely a priority, is getting those students eligible and ready to locate positions so that they're not, you know, pushing into the end of the semester still trying to find something. So the answer to that is we will begin working that the first week of school.
Excellent. Can you tell me a little bit more about what it would take to kind of be placed on the wait list, how you'd find out if you're eligible to do that?
So if you want to determine if you're eligible for work study, the first thing you want to do is you want to log into My WCU and take a look at your financial aid package. There you'll see the work study option. If you don't see work study there, you can email workstudy@wcu.edu, and I can check into that for you. If for some reason we don't have room in the budget for you right this very second, we'll certainly add you to the wait list and begin looking at that the first week of classes.
Excellent. Next question kind of coming in is for Nancy and Michael. A question about, can we fax or email documents to human resources? And then what if the Social Security card is laminated? Can they still use it?
No, you cannot fax your documentation into human resources. We have to see original copies. So we can't even look at it through a video stream. It has to be in person. So that's why you either would come in or we would have a remote agent. We can use a laminated Social Security card, but it does need to be signed. Your Social Security card does need to be signed. I had to have someone recently sign over the laminated because they laminated it before they signed it.
Oh, no.
In order to make it official.
Excellent. Next question is regarding interviews for positions. If you're an out-of-state student and you want to interview for a job that begins in the fall, how would you kind of handle that? Is there a digital interview process?
That would be based on the hiring managers. That if a hiring manager is willing to do a Zoom interview, then absolutely yes.
And that's when potentially they would take advantage of that hiring agent that you mentioned for those who would not be.
The remote agent.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
Michael, do students have to be 18 years old to apply for jobs on campus?
No, they don't have to be 18.
Is there any extra for those who may be underage, any kind of extra documentation that they would need to provide or parents would need to provide for those who are looking kind of to get a job when they get here?
Actually, another thing, but they do have to be 18. They do have to be 18, yes.
Okay.
And as long as they do have all those requirements, the eligibility requirements, they'd be eligible to work.
Excellent.
I apologize.
Oh, that's A-okay. As we move forward here, Catherine, you mentioned earlier kind of how to find the work study area. Can you tell me a little bit about different types of work study jobs? Are they all just kind of one type of job, or is there a wide variety?
That's a really great question. There are a lot of different types of positions. Work study, we encourage our work study students to find a job that is related to their major. So business students could find something working with the College of Business. We have office assistants. Sharon Crane is one of the supervisors there, and she's really great to work with. Athletics has a plethora of positions open doing all kinds of things, from, you know, working with the Catamount Club to, you know, working ticketing and things like that. They also have, if you're in athletic training, they have, you know, positions related to that. They have several different kinds of positions related to that. So that's encouraged. We also have the America Reads, America Counts program, which is administered by the Financial Aid Office. And that is, we partner mostly with education majors so that they get that real classroom experience by going in and working with the local schools at Jackson County and, you know, on tutoring, math, and reading to get them, you know, to where they need to be or to just to help them practice or increase their confidence. There isn't a specific limit on work study jobs. The main difference between non-work study and work study is who is paying you. Work study is going to pay you with federal funds.
Excellent. Thank you, Catherine.
You're welcome.
There is another question that we'll shoot your way, Catherine. Do the students in work study get a paycheck, or is it like a credit to the account?
It is a paycheck. So if you look at your MyWCU and you see that you have work study, you can earn up to that amount. So you'll work, you'll earn a paycheck, you'll be paid biweekly via direct deposit. Same rules apply as with a non-work study physician. And so you can earn up to that amount. And then once the funds are exhausted, they're exhausted, but you can earn up to that via paycheck. We don't take a portion of it and apply it to your bill or your tuition or fees or your student loans. This is strictly funding to help you, you know, make it through the academic year.
Excellent. Nancy and Michael, what is the soonest time somebody can start working on campus? Is there any restrictions for incoming first-year students?
No, there isn't. They could start before the semester. For non-work study, that's not a problem. And we are doing hiring throughout the summer, so there are job postings available. And we can do the remote hires if students are able to do the work remotely at this point.
Excellent. And is there any, as folks are going through, you mentioned a JobCat is where you would find kind of all the different types of jobs. Is there anything within JobCat that could help a student locate a specific type of job, whether they are looking for something that's more outdoorsy or looking for something that is kind of like at the library? Is there a way to kind of use the JobCat to kind of find specific types of jobs?
There is a search filter, so you can filter for specific positions you're looking for, yes.
Excellent. And is that something that is work study and non-work study, or one or the other?
In the drop-down options, mm-hmm. You can select work study jobs specifically. And some of those are also non-work study positions because they're hiring multiple students. That's just letting you know that you can be work study or non-work study. But yes, there is an exclusive list of just work study positions.
And you can work both.
Yes.
Okay, so there's no restriction on if you're work study, you can only work work study, or if you're not work study, you can only work not work study.
Right, you can work non-work study and work study, as long as you're not exceeding that 25 hours.
And how would that work? Are you allowed to have a job off campus if you work on campus as well? Is there any restrictions for that?
No,
There are not. And we don't count hours that are off campus. So if someone worked a position in town, for example, and did work study or non-work study, we don't count those hours.
It so would just be the work and work study and non-work study on campus that counts towards that restriction.
That's correct. Yes.
Can I go back to when we were talking about how many jobs you can have
on campus?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Work study is a little bit different than non-work study in that you can only have one work study position. You can only work a maximum of 20 hours mm-hmm. per week in that position. You can work a non-work study position as well and work the other 5 hours there, but you can't work 25 hours of work study. It is a combination of both. I'll give you an example. Orientation. Mm-hmm. You guys have students that work the front desk. Those students can work 20 hours as work study in the work study job, but then they could be orientation counselors for the other 5 hours that they can work on campus. And that would come out of, you know, your budget and not the financial aid budget.
Excellent. Thank you, Catherine. That's a good clarifying. So where can you access, what's the best way to find JobCat? Is there links to it through the main website, or are there specific kind of ways you can find it outside of just typing in jobcat.wcu.edu?
There are links on the website for it, yes. And you could search it just by using the JobCat, you know, URL. There's links all over the page on our student job page at go.wcu.edu/student-jobs. There'll be a link on there as well.
I also try to include a link in my communications to students as I begin, you know, working through those at the top of the semester, even on the wait list. This is the link for JobCat in the email so they can click and go right out to it.
Excellent.
You would just sign in with your Catamount student credentials.
Excellent. This is another question. If hired to work remotely, can an international student be eligible to work with the delay in the F-1 visa due to this current pandemic?
That's a very good question, and I would have to refer them to the International Programs and Services Department for clarification related to their visas.
Excellent. Is there any benefit to doing a passport versus a Social Security card?
Yes, it's very easy because it covers both identity and eligibility for employment, so that would be all we would need.
There is another job. There's a couple of questions in the chat about specific offices and their hiring. Do you know if the Campus Recreation Center will be hiring as usual? And then kind of dovetailing from that, that would be more general information. Is there any anticipated delay because of COVID-19 restrictions or guidelines for types of jobs that may be available on campus?
I would say yes, there will be some delay. And it won't be like it was last year, for example. There is mm-hmm. going to be some changes. And I think a lot of that depends upon how the semester is structured related to social distancing and gatherings and how all of that will look in the fall. So we'll probably have more detail about that as we get closer to the fall.
Excellent. Next question I want to ask is, you guys see more student employees probably than anybody else on campus just by the nature of your job. And so a question that's come in is about balance and kind of having a job while also being a first-time Western student. Now, our students that are watching this may be coming in as a transfer student or first-year student, but this will be their first time as a Catamount. Is there any kind of advice or any kind of trends you've seen for folks who are trying to work, you know, or trying to find that work and academic balance?
Yeah, I could certainly answer that. I think one thing that we all, whether non-work study or work study, try to make sure that students know is that they're students first, and they're here to complete a program, and that needs to be their main focus. Work is secondary to that. Just like with any job that you could hold, the goal is to establish a relationship with your supervisor. If you're you have something that comes up, you need to communicate that with them. If you're having some issues finding that sort of balance, you can communicate with your supervisor. We're at Western, and we are here to help you with, you know, with balance and navigate through this path that's going to lead you to a career, and definitely working on that, you know, communication aspect and, you know, knowing when you can't handle anymore, and then to, you know, guide you through that process is what we're here to do.
I think just having a job on campus helps you kind of be part of the community and just feel like you're more part of Western. So it helps you develop a sense of community, I think.
Is there, Nancy, you told a great story. I was in a training, gosh, this was probably, it feels like it was forever ago, but it probably wasn't too long ago. It just feels like forever since we haven't been able to hang out, and we're just now kind of starting to come back to work here, about having the Social Security document at home versus having it up here with you. And you told a story about how would that look? Isn't it safer to have a parent mail an important document versus sending it up here? And you had a surprising answer, I thought, when we did that training.
Actually, one of the things that we've heard a lot is that parents are concerned about giving the Social Security cards to their students for fear that they would lose their card. And what happens is if a student comes without a Social Security card and they want to work and they don't have a passport, then we are going to send them over to Franklin, which is about 40 minutes from here, to apply for a Social Security card. And they're going to send them a Social Security card in an envelope that is marked Social Security card enclosed. So we worry so much about protecting our identity, and the Social Security Administration is very upfront about what is in that envelope for everyone to see. So you're really not saving anything by not allowing that Social Security card, that original card, to come with the student.
Yeah, especially if there's any interest at all in working. You
absolutely
know you have to have it.
Mm-hmm.
Catherine, another question came in about work study. If students have work study on their financial aid package and they accept it, are they guaranteed job placement?
We do not place students in a position. As the same as with non-work study, you will go out to JobCat. The student will apply for the job. They'll interview. If they're hired, they'll complete the documentation and bring it. We don't place students. Now, if a student comes to me and says, I'm an education major, could you help me find something that's related to that, and I know of something that's available, of course I'll connect that student with a supervisor, but I'm not, you know, able to guarantee that I can give you a position, because sometimes a position isn't available.
If a student is interested in having a job at first, and they find that they've said, yes, I do want work study, or I'm going to start applying for jobs and I get a job for non-work study, is there any kind of penalty associated with changing your mind and not kind of not following through, or deciding that, you know, this work-life thing is not balanced for me right now, and I'm not doing a good job at keeping studies up and also working a job?
No, there isn't a penalty.
No penalty.
You know, as Catherine said, the primary focus is your education, and that's what we want you to put first and foremost. And if work isn't working for you, then we would much rather you step down and focused on school.
And that's one of the benefits, Catherine, of that wait list you talked about earlier, right, is for folks who do think they want to do work study and then get here and change their mind and don't want to do that.
That's
then
correct.
There's more people to take that space.
That is correct.
So advice for those, what should the main objective be for getting a job on campus when they come in? What would you guys say is the number one priority for folks who are looking for a job as soon as they start here?
I always encourage the work study students that I meet with to locate a position that is related to their major or has a service component where you're helping in the community. whether that be America Reads, America Counts, the Office of Accessibility Resources. I encourage the students that I work with to find something related to their major or something that's going to support them in the future.
Excellent. A question just came in regarding dining on campus, specifically kind of getting a job working with dining. Somebody has a job at Chick-fil-A back home and wants to potentially work at the Chick-fil-A here. Is that something that's done through student employment at Western, or is that done through Aramark?
It is done through Aramark. That is not a student employment position with us.
So for those who are interested in working in the food service side, that's not actually something they would go through either work study or non-work study to participate in?
Correct.
Yes.
However, and my friends at Aramark would kill me if I didn't say this, they are hiring, and you're welcome to check out their website. You can find it through the WCU official site. I can just see those guys like hunting me down if I didn't actually say that they are always hiring. So feel free, if you're interested in doing that, to reach out to them. As we kind of start to move towards the end of our programming, so a couple of more questions are coming in. Is hiring done throughout the year, or do you have to apply at the beginning of the semester to get a job?
Departments are always hiring throughout the whole year. Yeah, so it didn't have to just be the beginning of the semester. Always people are looking for help.
Do you guys find there's a time of year where jobs are most plentiful or where folks are doing the most hiring?
I would say they are most plentiful in the fall to start, because a lot of positions, they are hired in the fall and they will be for the entire academic year. But then when there's also would be another, I think, spike for getting ready for the spring semester. So you would see more job postings in November, late November and December, or early January.
And we prefer to do the majority of our hiring within the first 2 months that the semester is open. We understand that students have different needs, and we'll work with them after, you know, work study closes. We're going to do everything that we can to make sure that those students, you know, have the support that they need. And if they're able to find a job in November, but they want to keep it for the rest of the academic year, we certainly won't penalize them because they didn't find something in the beginning.
Excellent. Will your job work around your class schedule if you're working on campus?
Yes.
Yes, and that's for work study and non-work study?
Yes, it would depend upon the supervisor and what the position is, but yes, because students, you know, their life as a student is primary. We encourage all of them to work around their schedules.
And with work study, students are not allowed to work during scheduled class time. So I guess that's a little bit different.
Excellent. A question just came in regarding work study. Earlier we talked about you have to be 18 to have a non-work study job on campus. Is that same fact hold true for work study, Kathy?
Yes.
Must be 18 to be eligible
for that
program.
Must be 18.
And is that at the time of hiring or at the time of enrollment for either question?
At the time of hiring for us.
At the time of hiring. Excellent. And jobs, I think you mentioned this earlier, but just another question came in. Jobs are available for students currently. So for those who are watching kind of at home right now, if they're wanting to go to JobCat, is that available?
Yes, there are positions posted now that we are hiring for. Yes.
Work study typically encourages supervisors to begin posting positions prior to the start of the beginning of the semester, so like the first week of August. And that's because we want all students who are coming into Western to have an opportunity to look at those opportunities and apply for those opportunities. So there's a little bit of flexibility there, but we don't offer work study in the summer. So you can get a job in the summer, but we wouldn't do any sort of hiring and I-9 and document processing until the first week of school.
We're looking for any final questions. So if you are watching from home and you have any last minute questions, feel free to shoot them our way. Any final advice or any kind of final reminders for folks as they get ready to enroll at Western and get ready to join us as Catamounts this fall?
I think I would just say, you know, really give it some thought whether or not you want to supplement your income while you're here. And if you do, I would start perusing JobCat now and just kind of make it a habit to look every week to see what has been posted and what's new for the fall.
Excellent.
I would encourage students that are interested in work study, want to be on the wait list, want to know how the process works, to just email workstudy@wcu.edu. I manage that inbox, so I'm pretty quick about getting back to people. And I think that's the best way to find out the information that you need, particularly with work study.
Excellent, Michael. Any kind of final tidbits or helpful hints?
Yeah, even if you haven't thought about student employment, go ahead and look in JobCat and see what's available. You never know, something might match up with your major and be great on a resume.
A final question has come in, and we'll call this our final question of the evening. If a student wants to wait until spring semester to get a non-work study job, when would you suggest they start looking? That spring or earlier in the fall?
I would say November. They should start looking in November, because I would think November, December, and January will be when those postings appear.
Yeah, and I'm glad that was our final question, because that gives us a little bit of time. I know that from an orientation perspective, we hire in, you know, October, November for jobs that really don't start until January. So if you're thinking you may want to work eventually, certain jobs on campus, like being a resident assistant, you have to apply, you know, 4 or 5, 6 months in advance for. Being orientation counselor, you have to apply 4 or 5, 6 months in advance for. So it's important as you think about, you guys mentioned, checking that JobCat on a regular basis, just seeing what's out there, because you never know what kind of opportunities, even if you're not looking right now, you may have to apply now for when you are looking later. We do want to thank all three of our guests today, Michael, Catherine, and Nancy. I was telling them before this started, it takes a special amount of courage to volunteer for our first ever live stream as part of orientation. So thank you all very much. I think you guys did awesome job, and we deeply appreciate you, because there's never a slow time in jobs and student employment at Western, so it's always busy, whether it's work study or non-work study, so we greatly appreciate the three of you joining us today. We do want to have a reminder for everybody watching that we have another live session tomorrow night where we'll be featuring health and wellness, so we'll talk about health services, the doctor's office here on campus. You can ask questions about health insurance, different things we're doing in regards to that. You can also, we're going to have our counseling and psychological services here, and our campus recreation center. Directors from all three of those areas will be joining us. So tomorrow is going to be an all health and wellness live stream. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you, panelists. We'll see you tomorrow night. And as always, go Cats!